今天呢，我们还有一位非常重磅的嘉宾，这个是在昨天才确认的啊，就是美国教育研究协会的现任会长啊 ，Shaun Harper 博士呢，会担任我们今天论坛的一个点评员。So today we actually have a very, very distinguished scholar, the current president of American Educational Research Association, Dr. Shaun Harper, will be served as the discussant for Dr. Carolee's talk. We just confirmed yesterday, so haven't got the chance to make the news to the whole community yet. So I'm going to quickly introduce Dr. Shaun Harper. Dr. Shaun Harper studies racial, gender, and LGBT issues in corporations, law firms, Hollywood production companies, K-12 schools, and universities. He's also an expert on college sports. Dr. Harper has consulted with more than 200 business and institutions on strategies related to unity, diversity, and inclusion. He has published 12 books and over 100 peer-reviewed journal articles and other academic publications, and produced 13 million in research grants. His research has been cited over 10,000 published studies, The Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Fortune, Washington Post, Black Enterprise, and several thousand other news outlets have quoted Professor Harper and featured his research. He has interviewed on CNN, ESPN, and NPR. Prior to becoming a faculty member, he was assistant director of MBA admission for the Indiana University College School of Business. Dr. Harper spent a decade at the University of Pennsylvania, where he was tenured full professor. 好，接下来我们把我们今天的点评员 Shaun Harper 博士呢做一个简单的介绍。我们今天非常的荣幸邀请到了美国教育研究协会的现任会长 Shaun Harper 博士担任 Carolee 博士的点评员。Shaun Harper 博士呢，是在 K-12 学校和大学中研究种族、性别和 LGBT 的问题，还是大学体育方面的一个专家。他已经出版了，已经跟200多家企业和机构就公平、多元化和包容性战略进行咨询，出版了12本书，发表了100多篇同行评审的期刊文章和其他学术版物，获得了$1,300万的研究基金、科研经费。他的研究被10,000多项已经发表的研究引用啊，曾经在《华尔街日报》、《纽约时报》、《财富》杂志、《华盛顿邮报》、《黑人企业》以及其他数千个新闻媒体都被引用。介绍他的研究成果，他也曾经接受 CNN、ESPN 和 NPR 的采访。在成为教育工作者之前呢，曾经是印第安纳大学凯利商学院 MBA 的招生主任。哈珀博士呢，在宾夕法尼亚大学任职10年，是现任宾夕法尼亚大学的终身教授。好，我们掌声欢迎两位。
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Lee, for such an inspiring.Very, very rich and insightful presentation. You know, responding to the brilliance of Carolee is a real privilege for me. I have been a career-long appreciator of her ideas, of her scholarship, and her activism. We saw all of that evidenced in this talk. I realize that we have 23 minutes left, so I will attempt to be brief.Although Carol has given me so much to respond to here. Let me start by just saying that her lessons for humanity, she opened with that. And, you know, really it was the through line for the entire presentation. I think each of us should walk away from this experience reflecting very deeply and sustainably on the lessons for humanity.Not just the lessons in this current moment, but really connecting historical periods with the current moment and thinking about the lessons for humanity in a global interconnected way into the future, is certainly a thing that I will be doing long, long, long after this talk, because of Dr. Lee's brilliance. She is absolutely right that COVID-19 has revealed inequities within and across nation states.I appreciated how very thoughtfully she did it using data from a multitude of sources to help us understand that, you know, the pandemic knows no limits. It has no boundaries. It is, in fact, a thing that if we were thoughtful about it, you know, we could use it as a connecting experience as opposed to a divisive one. You know, it has been just absolutely frustrating for me as an American to see the leader of our nation, you know, use the coronavirus and the pandemic as a wedge as opposed to an opportunity for us to come together. I hope that we could be more like Carol Lee, less like Donald Trump, and understanding how the suffering of this moment in the pandemic can be used as a way to unify us, to help us understand, you know, really the interconnectedness of suffering and human struggle and resilience. I'm going to come back to her resilience theme in a moment. I appreciate it that Professor Lee has also compelled us to think about the intersectionality of poverty with ethnicity and race. That is a thing that I have found often missing in, you know, the analyses of social scientists and others, you know, who have thought only narrowly about the racial and ethnic disproportionalities of the pandemic and not so critically about the poverty and socioeconomic implications. Those are very much mutually informing and interconnected, not just here in the United States where she and I live, but really across the globe. As we look at those who have been most impacted so severely and so disproportionately by COVID-19, it has been poor people. And again, that poverty tends to commingle with people of color and ethnic minorities in various places around the world, as Dr. Lee has helped us to understand. I appreciate it that she talked about, you know, her surprise of seeing a Kentucky Fried Chicken in other places around the world. I too had that very same surprise as I started traveling internationally in my early 20s. You know, I did not expect to see, you know, McDonald's and KFCs and, you know, other Walmarts and other things, other American businesses in other parts of the world. But what she was doing in the illustration with that one slide with the KFC, and she said it, that, you know, it's really that our ideas, practices, goods, and services travel across continents and across countries. In the moment that Professor Lee made that really important point, using KFC as an illustration, it made me think about how it's not just ideas, practices, goods, and services, but there are some other, you know, I suppose these are ideas, but there are ideas that become weaponized. Xenophobia, homophobia, and anti-Blackness, for sure, travel across continents and across countries. Just like those McDonald's, just like those KFCs, xenophobia, homophobia, sexism, and anti-Blackness travel. They know no borders. I'm going to come back in a moment and say a bit more about that. I appreciate it that Carol helped us understand that there's tremendous diversity within nations that are presumed to be homogeneous, and that each country, in her words, wrestles with diversity. And I so deeply appreciated how she helped us understand how that wrestling with diversity plays itself out in outcomes. Certainly, we see it in educational outcomes, but we also see it in economic outcomes, in wealth, and health outcomes, in employment outcomes, and really in just about every statistical measure and metric of wellness and well-being across the globe. We see that there is a wrestling with diversity that is just so painfully ever present in the statistics. When we look at again, just about every statistical metric of achievement, wellness, progress, and performance, it really is ethnic minorities and people who have been deemed racial minorities who are at the bottom. That is a wrestling that I think really invites a global conversation, because it's not just a thing that we see here. You know, certainly at the USC Race and Equity Center that I founded and direct, we do lots of disproportionality analyses, lots of analyses of racialized outcomes. But honestly, if we looked at that same, those same metrics globally, we would see very similar patterns of persistent disadvantage. I appreciate so much that Carol Lee has, you know, really compelled us all to think about that through a global prism in her talk this morning. I appreciate it too, her language around the perennial dance with difference. You know, that dance could be a beautiful one. It could be one that is in fact inspiring, one that is rich with learning from, you know, the diversity and the, you know, the array of cultural histories, cultural traditions, and cultural richness. But instead, that perennial dance has been one often of conflict, one of, you know, of disproportionality, one of, you know, certain groups believing very strongly that they belong at the top and others belong at the bottom. You know, in my work, we call that white supremacy. You know, the dance doesn't have to be that dance. It could be, you know, a dance that is much more harmonious, much more humanistic. So, you know, Carol, I'm going to continue to think about how I, as an individual, can help people dance to a different tune as we, as we strive for, you know, more collectivism, you know, across our planet. Just a couple more things, and again, I wanna make sure that we leave some time for some Q&A. Carol deserves to hear your questions. I appreciate it, Carol, that you explicitly and very, very boldly named that the U.S. nation was born out of two genocides. That was really important. I appreciated the parallels, the historical parallels between China and the U.S. And those tensions and the inequities that have persisted, you know, across both contexts. Carol, you had us think about how humans learn to hate. You didn't spend a lot of time there, which I appreciate. I think that many of us have come to understand that hate is a thing that is both taught and learned. But I at least appreciated that you made a quick mention of it. It also had me thinking about how we as educators and as education researchers, how we might explore empirically and experientially how those who are so deeply hated can still have hope and self-reliance and resilience and resistance. You know, that's been a thing that has been really at the center of my scholarship. Anti-Blackness is a global phenomenon. It most certainly is a deeply entrenched phenomenon here in the United States of America. For the entirety of my career as a scholar, I have been deeply interested in studying how Black people who are so deeply hated in these United States of America still have managed to thrive educationally despite that hate, how they've managed to perform academically and professionally despite the barriers that have been placed upon them and in front of them and in front of us for generations. That is an empirical question that I think that we should continue to pursue. On the one hand, we should absolutely come together as a coalition of peoples across the world and as a coalition of scholars to oppose anti-Blackness, to oppose xenophobia, to oppose xenophobia. But on the other hand, we should also come together as researchers to explore how have the people who have been so chronically disadvantaged for generations, for centuries, how have they managed to thrive and resist and be resilient? And what might we learn from their resistance, their thriving, and their resilience that might be instructive as we attempt to improve the lives, the experiences, the conditions, and the educational circumstances for people like them moving forward? I think this is a both and project. It is a project of constant opposition, but it is also a project of constantly exploring those phenomenological undercurrents and enablers of resistance that Margaret Beale Spencer has so brilliantly explored in her work, and certainly that Carol Lee lifted up for us here today. I want to just say one last thing here in closing before we open this up for questions. Professor Lee, I appreciated that you pushed us to think about resilience in the midst of extraordinary human suffering, that is this pandemic. We have seen such suffering across every continent, but we've also seen such tremendous heroism. We've seen so many brave people come together in pursuit of the preservation of human life throughout this pandemic. There's power in the artifacts that you lifted up, and I appreciate it that you had us think about how might we co-construct new artifacts and bring together artifacts from a multitude of contexts around the world, particularly in this moment, to construct and co-construct a new narrative of human love, solidarity, coalition, and so on. I'll stop there and just say that once again, I am so, so grateful that I was afforded the enormous privilege of responding to the brilliance of Carol Lee. All right, I will turn it back over for what appears to be 9 minutes now of Q&A.
So Dr. Boynton, I think you.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Harper. Right now we have about 9 minutes. We can open it up and see if we have any questions from the audience. All right. So to minimize the interruptions, people can just type their questions in that. Let me see. We have one question for you. Okay, so the question is, let me see. I want to ask Dr. Lee a question. Today, the Black Lives Matter, the protest, is also caused a lot of the clashes between people and the police, and also caused a lot of damage. So what's your take on this? And what can we do to better fight race for the people of color? A lot of questions, actually. Okay. All right. So this is just a question I found. Okay. So do you want to respond to that? I think you pretty much mentioned in your talk about the power of artifacts and technology travels. So maybe anything else you want to add to that?
Just want to add that in the United States, as is in many other countries,
right,
there are complex groups in tension. So in many of these marches where you saw violence, the evidence suggests that they were being carried out by, in some cases, white extremist groups that would integrate into the march and then create this violence in order to try to keep people away from seeing what the protest was really about. So that it's complicated in the United States about how you see this unfolding. There was also in the chat a question, a comment or question about a recent decision by the President of the United States around international students. And I would argue again that this is evidence of attempts to divide people rather than bring them together. And there are a number of universities, including my own university, Northwestern, that are fighting division in the courts.
Okay, there's another question. Good morning, I would like to say thank you for your speech, and I would like to get your opinion regarding your topic on race relationship and law enforcement. Most Americans believe many times when police citizens use force, it's justified due to the criminal conduct the individual is engaged in. Do you believe African Americans are targeted just because of their skin color? Okay.
Yes, I do.
Okay.
One of the things that has come out recently in the United States, there's been an increasing move for the police to have body cameras so that when they interact in terms of arrests, there's a video record of what's going on. So if you look at them both in terms of George Floyd and then the young man that was recently killed in Atlanta, you see these long transcripts of these Black men saying that they are cooperating with the police and it doesn't matter. And if you think back, for example, to the killing of Tamir Rice, a 12-year-old boy with a toy gun, the police didn't even stop to determine this was a child and not a man. And as soon as he saw him, just shot him dead. So no, it is not because of criminal acts or resistance. It's because there has been a history in the United States, particularly of seeing Black male figures as dangerous.
All right. Okay. So that's a lot of questions. Maybe you can look at the chat box. 那我就刚才因为打字实在打不过来的，那刚刚问答的就是说，当我们警察跟民众引起冲突的时候，好像总是针对的一个黑色的群体，那这个是不是仅仅因为我们是的一个肤色的问题？那刚刚Carolee的回答是呢，的确是因为肤色的问题，比方说那个孩子12岁，因为拿着手举玩具的一个枪而被枪杀的话，是因为我们在传统的一个理念当中呢，大家觉得黑。 黑人的这个男性就是一个罪犯的一个形象。Okay, all right. Do you want to respond? Maybe one more question. 3 minutes left.
Sure.
Okay. The question is from Rodney Hobson. He says, "Thank you, Professor Lee. What an inspiring, thoughtful, and prescient topic for the world. Would you tell us what was the intent of the baby's film? With my own research and background in." Namibia, I understand the role of the Himba community in raising babies and the culture artifacts that they're over Himba use. So were you simply showing babies in different culture places, but remind us what you want us to know? I bet you didn't have time to elaborate, but it was also quite powerful too. So help us with the semiotic and also culture and analysis of the baby film.
So I show the baby film quite often because I think it shows very clearly two important points. One is that as human beings, we share common tasks that we have to accomplish because we're human, but that we do them in very different ways. And I use the film to try to show the point that diversity in terms of cultural pathways is normal. It is that diversity of different ways of coming to accomplish the fundamental task of being human that allows us as a species to survive. And what is clear to me when you look at the film is that each one of those babies is accomplishing the fundamental task that they have to do in the first year of life. The first scene of the babies who are quarreling with one another, having to read the internal states of other people, trying to get what you want from you know, from other people, learning how to manage, manipulate objects, how to walk. This is what humans must learn in the first year of life. But the fact that they're able to accomplish these in very, very different ways says to me that culture, diversity of experiences is normal, is important, and is essential. And it comes to me most clearly by looking at those babies and not hearing any words, just seeing them all work in different ways to accomplish the same goals toward different social ends as well, and with different kinds of supports.
All right, so our time is up. So anything else to add before we end, Dr. Lee? It's officially now 10:30. I think our time management went right. Extremely well today. Okay.
Well, one, I just wanted to thank you and the Sino-American Education Research Association for inviting me and including me in this. I think everyone knows that these symposium will be going on through October, and I think it provides a really powerful example of exactly what we're talking about, of bringing people from across the globe together to talk about the important kinds of challenges that we face in this day and time, of which the COVID is just a window into the challenges that we face. And it's through cooperation and talking and engaging with one another that we're able to move through these. So I thank you and applaud you for doing this work.
All right, so thank you very much. 好，那刚刚翻译来不及，其实它就是感谢我，感谢中美教育研究协会能够创造地球村这一个论坛，而且是这个论坛要持续到十月份，能够把各种呢不同的肤色、不同民族、不同种族的人团结在一起，然后大家一起齐心协力呢去创造一个更加美好的社会。好，那到这里呢，那我们的今天的报告呢就正式的结束了。我在这里呢也非常感谢。我们所有的人的参与。So, all right. So, thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Carol Lee, for a truly inspiring talk. And I learned a lot myself. And also, thank you, Dr. Shaun Harper, to join us in the last minute. Okay, very, very short notice. We really appreciate it. And so, before we end, I also wanted to thank all the audience for participating, for listening, and or sharing your questions and comments and everything. So just like Dr. Carey said, with unity, with like Dr. Shaun Harper said, with, you know, when we work together, we can make a difference. So before we end, I want to very quickly announce our future events. On July 18th, Dr. Kai-Ping Peng from Tsinghua University will be giving a talk about positive and united, applying positive psychology to fight the pandemic together. And again, the time will be the same. We moved it 1 hour late because people in the West say it's too early for them. Okay, so hopefully this way will work a little bit better for them. All right, so that's all. Thank you very much. And for all the friends in China, have a good night. And for all the friends in America, have a wonderful day. I want to share one thing is I truly believe it is not the people of power, but the power of people that can really change the world and change the history. So thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing you all in our next forum. Thank you. Goodbye.